So, good morning to everybody, and thank you for being here in our chain of seminars in the doctoral courses of the program of Statistics Optimization and Applied Mathematics. And it is my pleasure to introduce Professor Chaoqi Zhang from the Polytechnic University of Hong Kong. I will say just a few numbers, but in my opinion, they are impressive numbers. His research interests are mathematical optimization, vector optimization, variational analysis, and financial optimization. And I have found in MathSciNet database 245 publications and 2,700 sites by nearly 1,000 authors, 889 authors. Also, in Scopus database, we find 94 co-authors and an age index of 32. So I think this is enough presentation. So we are absolutely proud of having you here. It is our pleasure, and we are yours. So please, when you like.
It's a very pleasure here to be in this university, give a talk, and a very kind invitation from Professor John Parra. I don't remember the co-author is 94 or something, that many. Anyhow, that's probably the number I'm going to explore. So my talk probably will be kind of two parts, probably just one part. So as the title says, the local error bound, of course, that's the major topic. So in the first part, something like we try to do some kind of necessary and sufficient condition for the local error bound. Then the second part is more recent work in regarding to the modular of the error bound, local error bound. So the work is jointly with Kai-Wen Meng, who was my former PhD student in Hong Kong Polytechnic, and also Minghua Li. He was a student of my colleague in my hometown Chongqing. So we have this joint work here. To start, so I just general mention what about the penalty, probably some kind of relation with local error bounds. So normally you have kind of optimization problem here in regarding to objective function and with constraint here. So for the penalty, so now we have kind of penalty term, this kind of phi function, where is which is zero is equivalent to that the point is inside the set. So the set is, set C is what we are interested. So in that case, the penalty term, penalty function for this problem P, optimization problem P, which is in this form here. So now the penalty term here, so we can say the mu is a kind of positive penalty parameter here. So the question here is, whether there is a finitely large mu penalty parameter such that the local minima here is related to the local minima for this problem. So that's kind of, I say here, kind of exact. So we say if that penalty function is exact, then we say these two problems, original problem and the penalty problem, their local solutions some kind of equivalent. Then of course, if you want to say what you want to do here, if you want to find this phi function here, the indicator function delta C is obviously a choice. Right? But however, because the delta C, as we say, if the point is not in C, it takes the plus infinity. However, computationally, if you want to do the computational work, then this function is not so good. Right? So even though this is automatically exact penalty function, which is not basically computationally, it's not a good choice. So we aim to find some kind of better computationally attractive phi function, penalty function. All right, so that's exact here. So what do we want to do here? Basically, we want to, I want to here to see a kind of relationship between the penalty function and what I'm going to talk about here is local error bounds. So this one, there's obvious relation here. Say, if again, we talk about the same function here, which is kind of non-negative function. So as we say, it's a local error bound. It's a local error bound for the city C, and at a particular point X bar, which belongs to this C, if this kind of condition is satisfied. That means you have the distance from a point to the C is bounded by this given function, phi function here, locally, for such kind of things. So for tau function, tau parameter, and also this epsilon kind of neighborhood. So that's called the local error bound. All right. So for the local error bound, of course, another term here is if there's no restriction here for the nearby x bar point, then this is called a global error bound. So that's two versions here. Of course, there are many experts here in regarding to the local error bound metric regularity here. So I'm a student, actually. So related notations here are many: Kammner's subregularity or the weak sharp minimum. There are many, many related notations and the results here. So what's the relation between the local error bound and what I mentioned is exact penalty, which are related to by this kind of Clark elementary exact penalization principle. So what it says, this one is true if you have local Lipschitz, if the function is local Lipschitz, then if the point x bar is a local minima for the optimization problem, then this function, this point x bar is also a local minima for optimization problem where this phi function is replaced by the distance function. So the Clark exact principle claims that. So a point from the original problem optimization problem, local minima, which is also a local minima for this problem, for this problem here, but this one is replaced by the distance function. So that's Clark's elementary exact penalization. But with the notation of the local error bound, so this one here now can be replaced by this local error bound by this phi function. So in that case, the Clark exact elementary penalization principle plus the local error bound shows that a point of the original x bar of the problem is also a local minima for this penalization problem because of this relationship, right? So that's basically the motivation why we studied, if you study the exact penalty, why you need to study this local error bound. So that's kind of relationship. Clark principle is talking about the general optimization problem. The constraint is kind of a set constraint. If you want to know more about this kind of things here, there are a book by Bonas and Shapiro where there's a version of the elementary exact penalization for the set constraint problem, where the constraint is g of x belongs to a set, kind of cone constraint. Right, a more general model. In another paper here by Schultz, they have a more another version where the problem is kind of complementary or MPEG problem, MPEG two-level MPEG problem, where you have an objective function, now you have a constraint. Constraint is a set of the complementarity problem. So there are more versions in regarding to this exact penalization. All right. Okay, now come to the local error bound. So in this part here, probably I'll have just two parts here. One, as I mentioned, the kind of we want to establish the necessary and sufficient condition, if possible, to kind of local error bound, right? Then later on in section three, part three, I'll talk about kind of modulus. For the classification, because there are many, sufficient conditions for the local error bound. Then many here, I classify some of those conditions here in two types. One says the derivative like objective for points outside the C. So the points now choose from outside C to approach the X bar or something like that. The second type here, we are choosing the considering the limit kind of limit where we use the points on the boundary of the C. Right? That's two kind of approach. Of course, the references here are listed, very limited. A number of references I do not go into very much detail here. But one thing probably I would mention here is by Aze and his collaborators, they used some kind of strong slope. Of course, the definition probably not belong to them, but to by Georgia or something. Yeah, Georgia. It's called the strong slope. Then they made a very good research using that concept to study the local error bounds. Before I do here, what I want to say here is kind of necessary and sufficient condition. So probably one straightforward, maybe most relevant result here is if you have a convex system, then the necessary and the sufficient condition for the local error bound can be represented by this inequality here, which says that because if the phi function is a convex function, of course you have the directional derivative. Now in that case, if the directional derivative is kind of bounded by this norm of the d term here, for any for this one here, for any d here in this normal cone, right? For this normal cone here, probably this is not necessary. We are considering at one point, if x bar is fixed, probably this is not necessary. So for any d in this normal cone here, if you have this one, so this is a necessary and a sufficient condition if the phi function is convex. Right. I'm not sure if there's any other necessary and a sufficient condition for the local error bound is function, if the function is not convex. I think that would be interest if you want theoretically if you have a kind of both way conditions. Okay, I try to do the first one here for the we try to use the approach outside from the outside the C constraint here. So in this regard, we'll use some kind of tools. Very many here, I list some here from the variational analysis. I briefly go through some of them. So we are talking about extended real value function. As then we are considering a particular point where this function is finite value. So the first one here is regarding to the regular subgradient. So we use this d hat. F of x bar, use this notation here, which we have this inequality is true. The secondly, then by using this regular subdifferential, then we can define the normal subgradient or normal subdifferential, this df of x bar here. So that's by using some kind of subsequence here inside this regular subdifferential. Right? If the thirdly, if we say the function is regular, if the EP graph of the function is regular in the sense of the clock, right? I don't want to go into much detail here. Then mostly where you're going to use this subderivative, that's a tool we're going to use. Basically, this former student, Meng Kaiwen, he did the PhD student in PolyU, I think. He graduated 2 or 3 years ago. We did, he made a very good use of this one, subderivative, in his PhD thesis. So by this one here is defined by using this limit here, in terms of this one here. So where we have this, the W prime is changing, tends to this fixed direction W here. So that's called the subderivative. All right. This one here I mentioned earlier, this strong slope, which defined by Georgi or something like this. So which basically some kind of define the limit sup here. So as you can see here, the numerator term is kind of fx bar minus fx, so plus. So this plus here means that we basically considering some kind of x point here such that f of x point is smaller than this one. If this one is bigger than this one, it's take a zero, doesn't mean anything. So we're considering the value of f here where it's below this given fx bar. So kind of you are approaching the function value from the below, function below, you are considering kind of lower slope here in some sense. So in that way, if you take the limit sup, so that's kind of, that's called the strong slope. Right. There are many, there also a survey paper by Aze recently, I think, I'm not sure, 2013, detail summarized on this use of the strong slope. Okay, by what do we get here? The first result is stated in this way here. So we are saying here, we talk about a point x bar. Right? As I mentioned, now the first approach is now we're using the points outside of the C. So the shaded point part is C. Now we are considering those kind of point x here, which is not in C. Right? So in that case, we have a ball around this point for this one here. So we have kind of this four conditions here. So tau and the tau this parameter and epsilon neighborhood. So the four condition here is first one here is we have the zero distance zero the distance from zero to this U-year subdifferential, which is positive. Then the second one is the strong slope of this phi function here, which is greater than this tau here. This x here, of course, as I mentioned, is outside C here. Then thirdly, it says that if we use, this is a distance function, I'm sorry, this is the subderivative. So there exists kind of point here, such a direction, such that this subderivative is negative. Then third, fourthly, is saying that for any alpha value, where we have this tau multiply this distance from x to this one here, is less than of this plus function, right? So what this one says here, something like this, this basically says that a more general local error bounds. So if you take the alpha here is equal to zero, then this basically is C to C. Then this one just the phi, which is non-negative. If alpha is z is equal to zero, then basically this is the local error bound function. In that sense, this delta condition is more general, or we can say it's a uniformly local error bound in terms of the alpha, where alpha here is arbitrary positive value. Or of course, this is a more stronger condition because this is true for all the alpha, but the local error bound is only for the alpha is equal to zero. So what we are saying here, now this four condition here. Now another point I want to mention here is there are two choices here. One is the tau, one is the epsilon. Now but one question you can ask here, you have a four condition. Then in each condition you have a tau. Now one question is, if the tau is the same in all the four conditions, then the answer is that tau could be the same in the four conditions, but somehow might be the neighborhood probably not the same. So in a way, you can change the epsilon, the neighborhood there, to make the tau consistent.
Okay, so all the four conditions here is hold for every x in the ball there? For every x?
Yeah, for every x. For every x. Yeah. Now, of course, here, as I say, the result here is that we have the implication here from 1 to 2. Then the equivalence here, 2, 3 delta here. So not last three are equivalent, but the first 1 and the 2 only are implication. Then further, if this phi function, I would say, if it is regular, which is a much stronger regularity condition, if it's true in here, then 1 and 2 are also equivalent. So there are additional assumption here. But the 2, 3, and the delta here, they are equivalent, then there is no additional assumption. Right. So that's kind of, I don't know what's probably sufficient condition. So this is a sufficient condition for strong one here. Then again, I mentioned this delta condition here, repeated here again. Of course, I said this is more general than local error bound, so which is sufficient condition. Then definitely, you want to see it is necessary or not necessary. So an example can be given by using this example taken from the paper by Stanisky and Doug Ott. Right? So they're choosing this kind of step function starting from zero here. If negative, the function is zero. If positive x here, then you take some kind of a step function here. Right? That means for different x in different range, so either it is a constant or it is a linear function with slope 3. Right? So somehow you can say for in this definition here, so this function here, if you draw a line here, a straight line here, I didn't draw that one, you can draw a straight line function here. So this is straight because if you only connect all this corner point here, so this function actually is y is equal to x. A slope one function here. So in that sense, what we could have this one here. So we have the function, this given function here is greater than this x plus function. All right. So in that case, we say the phi function is a local error bound function. Because the function phi is greater than this distance here. Or this distance is just equal to this one here. Then, what we want to say here is if the delta for the delta condition, then we can verify because this function here, where the alpha, the alpha here is taken as equal to zero. Now we can have this condition. But since if alpha is arbitrary positive constant, then this one. This condition, the delta condition might not be true. Now we can verify that is the condition is that the delta condition is we have this distance function is less than this one, but however, we can choose some particular sequence, say xk is equal to this 2 to the power negative k, which goes to 0, and all this alpha k here, which also goes to 0 in terms of this value. So we can show that this quotient here is less than this, which goes to 0. So in that case, there is no finite tau, the tau will be pushed to 0. So in that case, for arbitrary alpha, that delta condition is not true. So in that case, we say this is only a sufficient condition, not a necessary condition. Right? Then what do we say here? Now, we still haven't got a necessary and a sufficient condition for the local error bound, because the delta condition is stronger than the local error bound condition. Right? Even though for the delta condition, the uniformed local error bound, the 2 and the 3 are kind of necessary and a sufficient condition. So 2 is by kind of subderivative, then another one is by the, I forgot here. Yeah. So those two here are kind of necessary and sufficient for the delta condition, the uniform, but this is much stronger. But the good thing is here that if we come to a narrow class of the function, this maximum function, then we are able to obtain a class of the necessary and the sufficient conditions for the local error bound. So now we only come to a, because early the phi function is general, no restriction. So phi only a any function, right? But now this one here, phi, we have the function here, fi is differentiable. Now we have the phi here, the I index here for here is finite. There are only finite many here. So in that case, we consider this kind of maximum function here. All right. So coming to this one here, now we this is UE active index set. So where you put all the I index together, where the function is equal to the phi function for any x. So that's I of x here. Now here we introduce two notations here. So actually this study, the first part is motivated by this work, Herney and Ochoa. So they used kind of J index here. So for the given X bar, the J of X bar here, which is defined by this one here. So what are they using here? So as we say here, they are defining this I prime, which is a subset of this active index set, such that there is a XK sequence on the boundary. So they use the sequence on the boundary. The sequence goes to X bar, and for all the XK, the active index set for all SK here is equal to this one here. If this is true, now we close, we enclose this X prime sub index here as this J of X bar here. So J of X bar is a set of the sub index of the I X bar here. So the key point here is they use a boundary point. But what we are going to do here, we use the point X bar here is outside C. So that's the difference. We use here, the XK here is outside C here. All right, so that's another one, the one we introduced. So with this one, now we can come to have this equivalent conditions here. So what do we have here? One, the first condition here is local error bound. Then the second one here is a delta condition where the alpha is arbitrary. Then the third one here is zero, does not belong to this one. So kind of the distance from the zero to the subdifferential set is positive. Then the fourth one here is that for any sub-index set here in this set, we consider this subsystem here. So this one satisfies the MFCQ. So we have these four conditions here. We say they are all equivalent. So in this way here, for this sub a class of the function, kind of max of fx fix for this one here, I is still finite. For this class of maximum function, we say we have a class of necessary and sufficient conditions for the local error bound. So now we can have, in particular, of course, if you have this function is maximum of something, then these two conditions are equivalent. So the alpha arbitrary positive doesn't matter, which is again equivalent to the case where the alpha is equal to zero. Then also equivalent, if these two are equivalent, probably that's a key point, then we can have this one here. Then early, I mentioned here this J index from the paper by Henley and Ochoa 2005. What they did here is they show that SAQ plus this condition here, this third condition here, this I of X bar being replaced by their index set, then they show that the local error bound is satisfied. So in that case, we say, of course, they have the, we can have this one. So it is true, SAQ is implied by the local error bound. So it means that if the local error bound is true, then SAQ is satisfied. But the second one is not necessary. So in that case, we can have local error bound implies the SAQ, but the local error bound does not imply the B. Right, so a simple condition example here is that you choose the F1 is equal to X1 minus X2, then the X2 is just the negative X1. So this kind of two function, put them together. So in that one here, now if you choose the X bar is at the origin, then you can easily compute the J index and I index of this one here. So in that case, for this J index, because in that case, you are considering the point on the boundary. So you are two functions here. One is one function, another one is negative. The other function basically on the active set is X1 is equal to X2. X1 is equal to X2. So on the boundary of X1 equal to X2, then we're 1 and the 2 index are both active. So you have this J index here is equal to 1 and 2. Now if the point you are considering is outside of this boundary, so in that case you can have only one of these two function is active. So the I index here is either 1 or 2. So you can have only one is active. So in this case now we can say condition B does not hold because you have this one here. The third condition here is this one. Zero does not belong to the convex hull of this one. Where, because now if you choose the sub-index is this one here, now you can have convex hull is 1 and 2 here. So in that case, you have 0 belongs to this. Because you, as you can see, the sub-derivative of this 2 here just cancelled out. But if you only choose one sub-index here, then you cannot cancel out. So 0 does not belong to one of these 2. Right? So in that case, we can have a counter example says why the local error bound does not imply B. Right. So this one here we consider in the point outside the from the outside the CDC. More coronary we can consequence we can derive is that as we say here, Q and CQ, the quasi-normality constraint qualification, which was introduced early by Haixin in his book, as in this one here. So as a corollary of our result, we can say that this quasi normality constraint codification implies a local error bound. So remember here, we only assume the function is continuously differentiable. Continuously differentiable. But what we can say here is in the early result we found in by this paper here, Minchenko, this was 2011, they have this same results, but where they assume the function fi C11. In general, they assume the gradient of those functions here are local Lipschitz, right? So they have a little bit stronger assumption to get the local error bounds by using the quasi-normality constraint codification here. Probably the approach of the proof is different. They use the Lipschitz constant or something, which needs to be finite. But here we use only the subderivative. So we do not use the Lipschitz constant. Right? So that's one consequence we can have. So that's the first approach where we use the points outside of the CDC. All right. Now we come to say if we are going to use the limits of the points on the boundary, then what we can say here. So in this case, now we're going to use the kind of cone condition, the normal cone concept here in this case. Now what we can say here, now again, similarly to I think early definition, like in the variational analysis, now we have vector V here. Now it says is proximal normal, which is uses n of this set A here, proximal normal to of this set A to the point if this one is true, right? Then the second here is the tangent cone concept. Then the third one is a regular normal cone is defined by this one, which is defined as the polar cone of the tangent cone here. Then the fourth concept here is the normal cone, which is defined in here. I do not go into very much detail here. So one another one here is projection mapping. So P of the A, the projection of the X point to the A, which is defined as all the Y here, which have a smallest distance from X to A here, this projection mapping. So in this case here now, all the points now we're going to consider here, we're using the points, the xk will be now on the boundary. So the question here, because if you're choosing the point on the boundary, now if we're choosing this using the cone condition, then if you use the cone condition, then those point xk, of course, cannot be outside of the CDC. If the xk is outside of the CDC there, then this cone doesn't make sense. All right, so that's why if you consider here, this one here, so we only consider the cone condition here, use the cone. So in this case now, again, to start with, we can have this condition here. So what it says here, now we're considering this limit if here. For this one here, so as we say, phi xk plus tk vk here minus phi k, but this xk k here, because now on the boundary, that's minus here disappear. So we have this limit if as some kind of subderivative, some kind of limit here, but here only we have the k goes to zero for those kind of xk sequence, which is on the boundary. Then again, we have this, sorry, this is vk. This is, so this is v belongs to this one. Right, we do not specify vk yet. Vk are specified here. So v here is belongs to the normal cone. Now we have this general condition here. Now with the vk is chosen respectively in one of the form here. So in this case, we have kind of five conditions. So we have the general condition with this limit if is positive, with this choice here at the first. Then separated if you choose the VK in different way, now you can have a different condition. For example, if VK has no restriction for the choice, then this condition actually be used by the Stanevsky and the Ault in their very early paper 1999 here. Also in this condition 3, where this VK is choosing in this regular normal cone, this one here, which one is by using Yoffe and Altrada paper 2008. Right? So we have these five conditions here. So in that case, somehow we can show the implication here. One implies two, two implies three implies four, and five. Then five here, the last one here, is necessary and sufficient to the local error bound. Right? So that's the first result. The second one here, if we assume the phi function is continuous, then we can show 2, 3, 4 are also equivalent. Right? So in this case, we can get this kind of, again, local error bound sufficient condition where this one is used. The point xk here is on the boundary. So xk here is on the boundary. So kind of the proof here is, as you can see here, all this choice of the vk here in this five condition here, no restriction, a little restriction, more and more restrictions. So because all the set here is one is included by another. So this one here is kind of weakest one. So as you can see, the relationship here, relationship of those sets here, then immediately you can see the implications here. Right. So now the question here, so you are saying you are trying to get some necessary and sufficient condition. So we are saying those five conditions, could it be necessary and sufficient? But there is one thing here, you need to introduce some other conditions first. So we introduce here two more conditions, R1 and R2. So what is R2? We say if R2, this, which is another condition, if R2 condition holds, now we can have this 1 and 5, all conditions here are equal to the, are equivalent to the local error bound. And also if R2 condition, which is additional condition, is satisfied, you can have 2 and 5, are equivalent to the local error bound. So we need to some kind of additional condition to get the necessary and the sufficient conditions here. Now what is R1 and R2 here? So R1 and R2 here are this specific some kind of condition similar to the early condition I have. What it is here is that this limit if here, but here now we're considering the distance function. This limit if here distance from this point to the C is positive. So again, we have this limit here. So in this case, xk here is on the boundary, and v here is on this one here. So if this is true for all the vk in this one, for this one is true for all the k, so that's the first additional assumption is required, such that 2 to 5 are equivalent to the local error bound. So we need to have some kind of additional condition. Straightforwardly, we do not know if, for example, 1 or 2 or 3 is equivalent to the local error bound or not. Right? So again, we have R1 and R2. Under these two conditions, then we can do this kind of things. Again, necessary condition. So again, by using this one here, so we say, what do we have? This is the second condition. We have this one. Now we can say the condition 2 can be applicable to this case. We can get the local error bound. By this one again, we can verify this one here. So in that case, the VK here must choosing this kind of point here. So in that case, we can say we can apply this one here. But in the early case, if you use the subderivative, you cannot do this. But this one here, we can use the point on the boundary. Because now this boundary, in this particular example, the boundary is only one point. Because this is a special case. On boundary C is only x, this y is equal to 0, x bar is 0. So in that case, we can have this one here. But in the early case, if the xk is out of C, then you can choose the particular xk, then such that the early condition is not satisfied. But this one here, we can have this, use the point xk, if on the boundary, then we can do it. So that's some kind of advantage now if you use the points on the boundary. that's the first part. Then I'll come to the second one here in regarding to the modulus. All right, so this work is still ongoing. Probably will be finished soon, but not yet. So all right, so what do we have here? Probably I think I'll mention here, doing this work probably is due to the visit of the Professor Marco Lobitz. Your visit to Hong Kong that motivates us to, we have some of this work on, we are working on this. Early we have this, the maximum function is finite set. We were working on the if the maximum function, the index set is not a finite. We were working on that, but later on we are working on this one here. So if you can get some kind of modulus for the local error bounds. Right. So the definition is obvious. So the error bounds modulus so can be which is some kind of maximum tau such that local error bound is satisfied. So in that maximum tau can be defined as this kind of limit sub phi over this distance function where the x here goes to x bar, and also of course we need to have this one phi of x is positive, right, naturally. So that's the definition of this error bound modulus. What we get here is we get some general general results first. Now we come to some special classes. One is we get if the function is convex, then what we can do? That's one thing. Another one we get the next one here, if the index set of the maximum function is infinite. We do not get a modulus, but we get a necessary condition, necessary and sufficient conditions for the local error bound when the index set is infinite. But earlier I mentioned where that I index is finite. But here in this part, now we consider, we consider kind of maximum function where the index set is infinite. Right. So again, we need to have some paper here. I think this part here. So the I'm sorry if my reference here to the literature is, I think it's limited. If I miss something, please help me. All right. So I think this outer limiting subdifferential is very important. In here, so which is defined by Kruger, Fabian, in these two papers here. So I think Marco is the co-author of these two papers. So importantly here is that now in regarding to the outer limit subdifferential, which use some kind of sequence here in this normal subdifferential here, also require the function value of this sequence here is greater than that f of x bar here. So that's, I think, a very interesting feature here. So we require the points of xk where the function value is larger than the given point. So I think that's a very interesting character. So when this notion is introduced, it's very useful in this kind of study of the modulus. So another concept here, we are going to use this kind of support function of our set function here. So the support function is defined sigma A as this super over all the point in A such that this norm, the maximum norm of this one here. This another notion we're going to use is by Hu. H Hu, this one. So what is this one here is this. So now we're considering convex set. So a convex set here, we define this kind of end set here, which is kind of, the point is in the closure of this set A. And also, if you increase or enlarge the x a little bit by t of x, where t is greater than 1, then this tx is not in the closure anymore. That means kind of you have the, in this end set A, which consists of those points on the boundary of the A here, if you go beyond a little bit, of course, from the direction of 0, looking at that direction, if you, from that point, if you put tx, t is greater than 1, go beyond a little bit, then that point is not in closure of A anymore, so that point is in the end set. So some kind of on the boundary, or the farthest boundary from the 0, right, something like that. So end set A, it's an interesting character in our result here. That's this one. Then another one here is the, if you use this end set here, because now in this case you say the end set is far away the boundary of A, then you can define the distance to this set, so which is called the extent. Extent of the, oh sorry, this is A here. Extent of A is defined by this one here. So we're going to use all these notions here in this part. Okay, this result here again from the early, I'm not sure, as I mentioned, you have done a lot of work here. And my visit here is very limited, only 2 days. I'll try to learn as much as I can. All right, so this is a very important result here. The first one here, kind of estimation of the airbound modulus can be bounded from below by the distance from 0 to this outer limit, this one here. In the second case, here, if you have the function, so this one we require the lower semi-continuous function. Now, if further, if the function here is proper convex, then you can have this one is equivalence. So this, I think this is very good result. So you can see again, as I mentioned early, by this power up of the power is also a coercer of this one here. Very good result here. So we're going to make use of these two results here in our formulation. So what we can say here is that, okay, phi is a function, extended real value function. Now, of course, you have the point here, x bar is on the boundary. Then now, in this part, we are restricting the function is regular and locally Lipschitz, So here, the locally Lipschitz property is very important when we study this modulus. Otherwise, it might not be true. Right? If you say the residual function phi is not locally Lipschitz, it might be interest, because if the, but here we must assume the phi function is locally Lipschitz. So in that case, first we can derive this one here. As I mentioned here, this one has been established. If for any phi function, no semi-continuous, then we have this part here. This is the error-bound modulus is bounded above by the distance from zero to this outer limit subdifferential of the function, supporting function of this subdifferential set here. So I think this one here, what we did, how we get this one here is that because as we say, locally Lipschitz, then this subdifferential now for a local Lipschitz function, subdifferential is convex and compact. Then now we can have this supporting function is convex. Because if this is local Lipschitz means this is convex and compact, then the support function is convex. So if the support function is convex, now we can use early result mentioned here. If the support function is convex here, now we can have this one here is equal to this one for the support function. For the support function, we can get this one here. So now question here is, now we need to establish the relation between the modulus of the function here and the modulus of the support function. So basically we shall the support modulus of the original phi function is less than or equal to the modulus of the support function. Now we apply this one. Now we can get this equality here. Because for this one, we show this one is less than or equal to the modulus of the support function, or phi here. Now we show the use the early result, and we can establish this one here. So that's how we get around of this one here. So that's the kind of main results. So we kind of have a lower bound and upper bound of the error-bound modulus. Right. Now, of course, the question here is if the bound is tight or the bound is not tight or something like that. Or another way is how do you compute? How can you compute the, for example, local error bound, no modulus or upper bound modulus? How can you compute this too? That's another one here. I think one here we can say a little bit about this one here, kind of in the geometric sense that here. What do we do here? We have two propositions here, 3.1 and 3.2. So they are kind of similar. So in the first result here, we consider the zero belongs to this set, right? In the second case, we consider this zero does not belong to this one here. Because when you use the end set, when you use the approach is different. When you use the end set, so there are much a very big difference if the point is in the A, or sorry, the orange is in the A, or the orange point is zero is not in the A. When you using the concept end set A, so this kind of classification is important. Right? So what we can do here is that for the first case, if A is compact, now we have the convex, this compact convex, we have this one here. If zero belongs to this one, then we can have A and B here. So what A here is that, so we have this S is defined by the union of all this subdifferential of the support function. So A here is supposed to be the subdifferential of the phi function. All right, so this is basically a convex function. The subdifferential of the phi function. All right. So I just use a general. This can be a general set here, compact convex. So we define the S set here to be the union of all the subdifferential of the support function of A, where the support function value is positive. So S is defined by this something like this. One thing we can say here is, in a way that probably I'm not sure. For a convex function, if we assume the subdifferential is computable, I'm not sure because convex function, we don't know if for general convex function is computable or is not. Probably if you, because in the early result in the general inequality, we used the outer limit subdifferential. So we are saying that probably that one is not easy to compute. Because outer limit subdifferential, you need to have this kind of, the function value is greater than the given point at the particular point. Probably the outer limit subdifferential is not easy to compute, but my argument here is probably this is easier computable than now we introduce this one here. If this is true, then I say we can probably compute the city S here easily. Right. If this is true, then we say this S set here is a subset of this N set. This N set here is a subset here. So basically, this two set here is encoded between the S and the closure. So it says that, as you can say, this one here, there are only very little difference between the set S and the closure. All right, so there are very much a little difference here. So in that case, if this is inclusion is true, then easily you can say the distance here, all the distance here becomes equal. All right, we can say that. So in that case, that's the first result. Then secondly, we can say that the end set here now is equal to this if end set A is closed. Right. So in that case, of course, if this is closed, obviously you have these two here are equal. Then another way you can show if this are equal, then you can also show the end set A is closed. Right. From B2 to B1 is obvious, but from B1 to B2 is a little work. So this is where the case 0 in A. Right. You can obviously, similarly, you can get if the zero is not in the set A, we can get again similar result. So all results here are similar. So what I want to say here, probably a slide here, in this case here, so just say example, say this inclusion might not be tight. Just give an example here, A is equal to such kind of set here. Now we can compute the end set A and also the S. As you can see, this is closed, this is not. So in that case, we can have a proper inclusion here. So that's kind of, we use the end set to come to characterize this kind of S set here for this set. Yeah, we can do something for this. Another one here, example here is show kind of upper bound, upper modulus is overestimated. So example here again, we can have the upper bound here. So it says now we have a convex function, F1 defined as a quadratic function. Now F2 as a linear function here. Now you can easily compute the U-year subdifferential as a convex whole of these two because you only have two functions. In that case, again, we can compute this one here. As in this case, we have this outer limit is equal to the end set of this one. As you can see, this 2 point here is from the zero is to along the same direction to 1, 1. The half and half is in between, then of course end set is only 1 point. All right. So in that case, we can get this, compute this one as well, which is computed by this paper, 2016. So in that case, we can compute the modulus in this way, which is equal to this one. And another way here, the upper bound modulus, which is larger. Right. So we can have the over estimated upper bound. Right. One example here. Then in more specific case here says for the convex function, what we can do? If the function is convex, So in that case, so phi function is convex, finite, convex. Then first we assume the SQ is satisfied, and this one. Then the second condition here is that we said the CTC admits exactness of the tangent approximation. I think Marco has this introduced this one with Edie Anderson.
Anderson,
who is now in still working?
Yes.
Okay. So that's the ETA condition. So we have these two here, SEQ. Another one is ECQ of these two conditions. So in that sense, for the convex case, we can get the proper tight estimation of the error bound modulus. So all the bounds are equal. So this is for this one here. Now, more specifically, for a linear case, if you it's a convex case. If you consider the infinite many of the linear function, you take the maximum, of course, you get a convex function. Convex special case. So in this case, what we're going to do here is we assume now, of course, this is non-empty. Now, what we assume here is this here is locally polyhedral. So locally polyhedral in this case here implies the ETA. So this locally polyhedral property, which is defined here somehow, implies the early condition, the ETA condition. So in that case, from here, we can get the tight lower and upper bound here. So in that case, now that's the definition here that for any of this one, for any this kind of set, we can have this one here. In particular, that's the upper bound. In particular, we can have this one here. In particular, we have this. So where, again, this is the result by your group here, 2014. I think this is in Jota, right? Jota or?
St. Barbara's.
Okay. So we can have this one as the special case of ETA. I think the locally polyhedral condition or also this ETA property, I think we get into this one also with Vera. When Vera was in, Vera Washina in Australia, in Hong Kong, quite a few years ago, then Kai Wen Meng, we get involved and we studied this ETA condition. Also, they come to this locally polyhedral property. All right. Then finally, I'll come to this so-called this where if you have the index set I is not finite. Right. Again, you have a kind of maximum or super function. Now, in this case here, you have a free function which is maximum of f of x, y. This capital Y here is a compact set. So this one is more generally called as the lower C1. I'm not sure where is the early Tara Rockefeller has a very early paper on this topic. And also recently, not recently, in their book, famous book, they also have get more study on this topic. So what we have here is for function f here, both x and y, only for the gradient on the x1 here is dependent continuously, not just on the x, this subgradient here, also on x and also jointly on both x and y here. So that's the, I think, kind of key requirement. So if this are true, then there's two basic property are obtained in this book by Tara and Roger Weiss. The first one here is a function is locally Lipschitz continuous and regular on this seed O here. And importantly, we can calculate this subdifferential by this convex hull here. So that's two property importantly we're going to use. All right. With this one, we can again get some necessary and sufficient conditions for the local error bound. So first here, again, we define this kind of set here, where this xk here is kind of outside, not on the boundary, because now that means the phi of xk is positive, so it's outside of the C here. So again, we define this one similarly as before. So in that case, we can compute the outer limit subdifferential as this union of the convex hull here, where this y prime has any kind of index in this sub-index set here for this one. So convex hull has chosen this for a fixed y prime here. So this is true. We can compute this one. Then furthermore, we can say this this two property are equal. Basically, we can say, okay, phi is local error bound for this C at X bar, and also this kind of condition as we mentioned earlier when the index I is finite. But now if we have an infinite index, now it is Y. So this kind of condition is still true as a kind of necessary and sufficient for the local error bound condition. Also, the error bound modulus, this one here, is equal to this one here. Right. So to supplement the early case where this index set I is finite. Right. So that's the main result. A little bit roundup here is, of course, as I mentioned, in the finite index case, we have a paper on this topic, and also by Hilda and Kumar, they have a kind of this result here. Then we improve some kind of existing result by Henry Ochoada in 2005, and we did something with my co-author Zheng, Xinyi Zheng, some years ago, also on this. We considered this kind of use the points on the boundary in that paper. I think that's my the reference money here lifted here. I think, I mentioned this survey paper is much earlier, 2003, by Aze. Then I found some references here by Canovis. One is the Jota to appear, and Tolendo. Yeah, set value and variational analysis 2014. This Fabian paper, Henley, there are many, probably too many references here. But I do not go into very much detail. Partial difference in the paper. The paper is, I'm not sure when can the paper, the second part, probably in 1 or 2 months, we can finish the paper and send your copy. Yeah. Okay, that's roughly I want to speak. Thank you very much.
Maybe a silly question, but have you ever seen some, inner limit or subdifferentials?
Inner limit.
I say because.
So you mean the function value is less than other points?
Yes. I mean because we are also interested now in studying properties as Lipschitz lower semi-continuity. Mm-hmm. Roughly speaking, if you think about the feasible set, instead of measuring which rate it increases, mm-hmm. which rate it may decrease, it may reduce. So.
No.
I don't
Because maybe we have to develop our tools.
In the set, I'm not sure in the set would it be that useful.
Yes, to.
So you are considering the point is larger.
Well, in this.
This one is kind of, this one is smaller.
In this case, you just have to change the sign. But we have the feeling that sometimes it is not so easy as changing the sign. So if you put less down instead of greater down, I don't know what you could get. But just to ask if you know about it.
Mm-hmm. No, I'm for the moment I'm not so you are
not to think down, please. Yes, to
I think some curiosity, how do you conclude that this end set could play this crucial role in your analysis? No? Because it's beautiful, it's a very geometrical well. Okay, we were aware of the geometrical meaning of all this stuff, in particular of the outer limit. But okay, you succeeded just to translate this.
Yeah, exactly.
Through this set and array. This is a congratulations. This is very interesting.
Yeah, we studied this work as I mentioned when the. Vera Vashchena was in, because it's not so easy when you have a convex set, it is locally polyhedral. In the two dimension, it's easy to characterize, but in the high dimension, it's not. Some condition we get in two dimension is true, but in high dimension is not. Computationally, even say I say this one is more computable. I'm not sure how which sense.
Conceptually.
Yeah, conceptually it is. I'm not sure. Might be the outer limit. I think it's very interesting to say how can we do something computable. How do you compute this one? In the future, at least for some probably special classes of the function, not for the general, but for the special class of function, how do we at least maybe compare this outer limit with the later set, the end set where it's used, another one, which one is better, I don't know how, which one is more simple. It's always
computing. Challenging
idea. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Even though we still have some gap. We have some more result here to use on this line here, but.
Okay. Thank you. Really beautiful because this is the set. This end set is ya está comiendo. Very beautiful to find this general concept which is what we had in mind in that time, but we didn't succeed in finding this clear contour, so clear expression is very beautiful.
The components of the set A, okay, it can be relaxed,
I think it's very interesting. Yeah, the compactness. Now, directly as earlier, probably we only use the closed, A is closed. Mm-hmm. Compactness, I think it's a very good question. Yeah. If it can be removed, what does it mean? If it can. Regular locally Lipschitz, but locally Lipschitz always imply the compactness. the phi function is locally Lipschitz. Now you have the subdifferential is compact. If you have set is not compact, does mean we can relax the function phi, which probably is not locally Lipschitz. Because as all the characterization here, the locally Lipschitz is very important. If not, you cannot characterize the modulus. But as you know, in the literature, in particular in the sub-analytic or MPEG problem, normally they do not have the locally Lipschitz property of the residual function. Normally they have a kind of square root of the residual function, square root. So the residual function is not a Lipschitz. So I think probably it's very useful if the phi function to drop that assumption. Phi is not Lipschitz. I think that's related. If phi is not Lipschitz, probably the compactness is not true anymore. In that sense, I'm not sure. I'm thinking, see, if you have the if the function is not locally Lipschitz, one thing here, I'm not sure. We did some kind of second order condition. Not for this one, for the optimality condition. For if the penalty function, for example, power function, penalty function is a power function of the maximum, of the normal maximum function of a power, yeah, P, to the power P. So we have the kind of optimality condition is derived by assume that this kind of penalty function is exact. So for example, if you have the penalty function is the square root of the normal maximum residual, then we can use kind of second order condition. So I'm not sure if we introduce the second order subderivative or second subderivative here, can we do something for the kind of equivalent condition for the local error bound? Because the function is not a local, if the phi function is not a local Lipschitz, so the subderivative is not sufficient. Probably you need to use higher order information. Right? We only did some kind of that for the exact penalty by using this kind of low order exact penalty, then we say, okay, we can have the optimality conditions. But coming to probably, I'm not sure, probably still not enough. I thought about that a little bit by using normally the condition we employed to derive the optimality condition. Probably it's true for the derivation of the optimality, but to guarantee the local error bound, you probably need something more. Because anyhow, probably the second order information might be crucial. Yeah, if you have the phi function is not the locally Lipschitz in some sense, but only that one is not enough. Probably you need some more here.
Any other questions? Comments? Thank you again.